Hey everybody. Before I get started, I do want to go ahead and acknowledge that I'm just getting over a cold virus that I've had this week. So if you hear some sniffles or some coughing, I apologize in advance for that. Anyway, what I'd like to do today is sort of do what we did at the very beginning of the semester when we looked at 1970, and we kind of analyzed what was going on in 1970 and looked at the demographics and economics. But instead of doing 1980, because we've already gone a bit into the 80s at this point, I want to do it with 1984. I would argue this is the quintessential 80s year. I think this would be even more obvious in part two, when we get into the popular culture of movies and television and music. I think so much of what people think of as the 80s really has its origins, in particular, in this year. If I had to pick another year, I might go with 85, but to me that's, if you're talking about 80, 81, 82, you're still very much in the 70s. I think the 80s hadn't really quite found itself yet. And by the time you get to 87, 88, 89, the 80s are beginning to get a bit bloated. So to me, this is the sweet spot, not only for pop culture, but also for politics, and for world events. Now, we've already talked about Cold War events, which we'll come back to. We were looking at 83 going into early 84. We've talked about the AIDS epidemic, which really kind of broke through in 1984. So, consider that as part of the 84 phenomena. And we even talked about the video games rise and fall, which also happened at the end of 83 and into 84. So, again, so many of the big stories of the 80s do seem to center around this late 83 to maybe early 85 period. So anyway, let's get started. We're going to do it in two parts because there's a lot here. The first part is dealing with politics, the 84 election, economics, government, and then part two will deal with the popular culture side and prices of things and some of the new products coming out. So anyway, we'll do part one for now. So even though it doesn't happen until the summer of 1984, I think, again, the sort of culturally speaking, I mean, the big event of the year was the 1984 Olympics, which were held in Los Angeles. Again, this is still a period where Winter Olympics and Summer Olympics were still within the same year, which I personally always liked. It was just a full year of Olympics. Now they do them every 2 years. It's winter, and then 2 years it's summer, and then 2 years it's winter again. But this kind of, again, 1984 to me is the height of sort of American power, American confidence in the post-Vietnam era. A lot of people have compared the mid-80s to, say, the mid to late 50s, not only because baby boomers who grew up in the 50s were now adults in their 30s and early 40s, and now we're running everything. And so many movies were evoking the 50s, and a lot of bands from the 50s and 60s were making comebacks in the 80s. But again, there was that same sense of the economy's great, although we're going to talk about that. It may not have been as great for everybody, but the economy's great. We're winning the Cold War. We're in a Cold War again. It peaked in the 50s, early 60s. It's peaking again in the mid 80s, but we're winning it. And there's a sense of Americans are united again. And again, 1984's Olympics really exemplified this because it was held in the US. And so it was American flags everywhere. And of course, it comes right in the middle of the election season. So this was a big boost for Ronald Reagan. It was his hometown. Well, he really is not from LA, but that was his adopted hometown as an actor, later governor of California. But of course, one of the big things about the US Olympics, or excuse me, see, I slipped there, the Summer Olympics held in the US, they were basically the US Olympics because Russia boycotted it in revenge for what we did in 1980 by boycotting their Olympics held in Moscow. Because of their invasion of Afghanistan. I don't know if these people are quite as big to younger students today, but I mean, this was sort of really I think the height of Olympic celebrities. You have Bruce Jenner, now known as Caitlyn Jenner from the 70s. I think he was 76. Mark Spitz from the 72 Olympics. Nadia Comăneci, also from the 76 Olympics. But really, 84 was, people like Carl Lewis and Mary Lou Retton, the first American female to win gold medals in gymnastics. I think she ended up winning five medals altogether. But again, because the Russians and much of the Soviet bloc were not in the Olympics, because that's what the Olympics used to be about, from the 50s really till the early 90s, it was the communists versus the capitalists, the Russians in particular, the Russians versus Americans. And we always said they cheated, they used pro athletes, they used steroids. Of course, we now use pro athletes, and it turns out everybody uses steroids, but still, there was this sense that we're playing fairly, they're playing unfairly. And so the Olympics were always kind of a proxy Cold War and or hot war proxy for the Cold War. But again, since the Russians boycotted it, except for Romania, Romania did indeed go ahead. I mean, you can almost see the beginnings of the end of the Cold War as Romania is basically rejecting Russia's call for everybody to boycott it. But again, without the Soviet bloc, you do see how much the United States dominated. We've never dominated Olympics as much as the 1984 Olympics. It was, and some of the events, it was almost a joke, just how badly we were winning in many cases. But you can see even little Romania comes in second. So that gives you a hint of, well, what would have been like if East Germany had been there, or Poland had been there, or Russia had been there. How little would we have won compared to some of them? Who knows? Anyway, so in many ways, the Olympics, for Reagan at least, the Olympics were kind of the opening of his campaign for re-election in 1984. Now, again, today, the myth of Reagan, the popularity of Reagan, everybody knows he won by a landslide in 1980 and then a bigger landslide in 1984. Even though when you drill down on the numbers, once you get past the electoral vote, those numbers are a little bit smaller, but still, we get the sense that he was super popular and all that. But you forget that going back into the time period, I mean, even 1980, as we've talked about, Carter was doing decently until the very end, despite all his problems. And 81, 82, even going into 83, Reagan was not that popular compared to later presidents. And the economy in 82 actually was tanking for a while. So it was not absolutely guaranteed he was going to get reelected in 84. Although by 1984, it was starting to feel more like this is a sure thing by the year 1984. So of course, the big election that year, Ronald Reagan, the incumbent, the Republican incumbent, versus the Democrats. Of course, it will end up being Walter Mondale of Minnesota, the former vice president for Jimmy Carter. And Reagan is going to win by a massive reelection. In fact, it's the biggest landslide in American history. He did have a couple of problems, though. Like I said, there's ongoing debates about his economic policies. I'm going to talk a little bit more about that in a few moments. Of course, his vice president was George H.W. Bush, his opponent in 1980 before he gets the Republican nomination. I mean, literally a last second choice to be his vice president. If you might remember, it was supposed to be Gerald Ford, but Gerald Ford didn't look like he wanted to be vice president, but wanted to be a co-president. Reagan ditched him for Bush. And the reason it was such a tough decision was because Bush and Reagan, even though both Republicans, were very, very different politically. Now, it is very typical for a president to choose an opponent to be their vice president. It kind of keeps the opponent sort of on your side. Sometimes it's known as the capture thesis. You capture your enemy on your side. And we do see that a lot. But nonetheless, I mean, Reagan, excuse me, Bush was on record in 1980, 79, 80, being highly critical of a lot of Reagan's policies, especially his economic policy. And in 1984, the Democrats were having a good time because now that we see Reagan's economics in action, there were lots of debates about those economics. And people kept asking Bush, well, didn't you call this voodoo economics back in 1980? And so here's a clip of Bush saying that, and then followed by a clip of Bush denying that he ever said it.
What I'm saying is that this type of what I call a voodoo economic policy, it just isn't going to work.
Last night, Vice President Bush was asked about that and corrected the record.
Well, what I said back then, it's very hard to find the. Actually, let me start over. One, I didn't say it. Nobody, every network's looked for it and none can find it. It was never said.
I'm actually a bigger fan of George Bush than I was when I was younger. And I don't know if I'll have a lot of time to get into George Bush, but I will illustrate some decisions he made that weren't popular that were actually really good decisions. But he was not always the smoothest when it came to, you know, it's like he kind of says things out loud that he's thinking in his head that he should be thinking and not saying. In fact, I didn't say it. Yeah, that's the ticket. I didn't say it. Sorry.
What I'm saying.
But nonetheless, despite, you know, the little bit of a Bush problem they had, it wasn't too big of a problem. And of course, Bush will go on to run successfully for election of president in 1988. He'll remain a very loyal vice president for the 8 years under Reagan, even though I may talk about this more later, even though the Reagan family and the Bush family did not get along. The first ladies hated each other. But I'll talk more about that when we get into the 1988 election, because that's going to be a problem. So this is a typical Reagan campaign ad from 1984. Which is quite a contrast to some of the campaign ads you would see in the 70s, which weren't always negative about America, but were a little more like less triumphalist, less rah-rah America. But by 1984, that had become, you know, much more prevalent, especially in conservative circles. Today, that sounds very, that feels like a commercial you would see right now. But 1984, that was a new type of commercial. And a lot of you may recognize that song. That's a country singer named Lee Greenwood. He actually had a lot of hits, but pretty much his career now is singing that song wherever he goes. He probably hates the song. Donald Trump would play that at a lot of his rallies. And in fact, this practically could be a Donald Trump ad from 2016. You know, it's very similar. And Trump does base a lot of his campaigning on the kind of the Reagan model. But anyway, that was a big hit in 83, 84. And so at the time, it was a brand new song. It wasn't a 30-year-old song like it is today. Oops, one more. So this...
If this had been...
Sorry, I'm getting a little offhand here. This is Walter Mondale. He would be the Democratic candidate. I'm going to skip that. Sorry, I did get these slides slightly. I was like, I'm pulling a George Bush. I'm thinking out loud as I'm talking. And I'm thinking, do I want to re-record this? No, I'm going to skip the slide and go back to it. This is the Reagan quintessential ad, though. This is known as the morning. That's M-O-R, not M-O-U-R. Although Democrats had a good time saying, no, we're mourning in America because of Reagan. But this is like, it's mourning in America. People are getting up to work. So this was the Reagan ad from 1984.
It's morning again in America. Today, more men and women will go to work than ever before in our country's history. With interest rates at about half the record highs of 1980, nearly 2,000 families today will buy new homes. More than at any time in the past 4 years. This afternoon, 6,500 young men and women will be married. And with inflation at less than half of what it was just 4 years ago, they can look forward with confidence to the future. It's morning again in America. And under the leadership of President Reagan, our country is prouder and stronger and better. Why would we ever want to return to where we were less than 4 short years ago?
It's a powerful ad, and you can already see from earlier ads that I've played in this class that, you know, there's a more Hollywood quality to a lot of these ads. There's a lot more effort made to make these look really good. One thing, I mean, they do get a little bit negative, but one thing, you know, recording this on actually Veterans Day 2022. We just had the midterm elections a few days earlier. And I don't know if there was an ad that wasn't a negative ad about somebody's opponent. It seems like every single ad is just knocking the opponent. That wasn't as big of a thing in 1984 yet. I mean, they would criticize opponents, but it's really 88 and then 92 where negativity really becomes a regular tool in TV politics. So that's one thing. I mean, there will be some criticisms, but nothing like what we see today. It's a powerful ad. I mean, of course, it's doing that classic line of, you know, ask yourselves, are you better today than you were 4 years ago, which people say all the time now. That was a kind of beginning. Reagan kind of started that phenomena. It is a very middle class ad. It's an overwhelmingly white middle class ad. So it is targeting a very specific part of America who were doing pretty good in the 80s. There were other populations that felt worse under Reagan, perhaps, but it was a very effective ad, and obviously it worked because Reagan does get reelected. I'm going to go back to the Mondale clip, and I before I get to Mondale, this was a big deal for Democrats because they're starting fresh. You know, Carter's gone; they don't have to renominate him. And so a lot of Democrats jump into the mix to run for president, because again, it's anybody's game at this point. And there were a lot of major Democratic candidates, in early 1984. And some of them do kind of make history. We do get our first astronaut, our first person to go into space. John Glenn has a pretty good shot for a while of being a candidate. We have seen African-Americans run for president before, but not at this level. And of course, the former associate of Martin Luther King, civil rights activist from the 60s, community activist Jesse Jackson was a major candidate. And even though he didn't get too close to getting the nomination, he did a lot better than a lot of people would have guessed, you know, talking less than 24 years after kind of the end of the civil rights movement and almost, exactly 20 years after the 64 Civil Rights Act. But it does wind up being Jimmy Carter's former vice president, Walter Mondale from Minnesota, who does get the nomination. A really nice guy, only fairly recently passed away. Very, very smart, a good Democrat, not too one way or the other. But there's some people thought he may have the quote unquote stink of the Carter administration, because again, with such a heavy loss in 1980. And by this point, now there is a full-fledged Carter was a terrible president kind of attitude in America. And so there was some hesitation on Mondale's part. A former U.S. senator before he becomes vice president, later will go on to be an ambassador to Japan under Clinton's administration. Now Mondale is kind of seen as like the classic terrible Democratic candidate. You know, he was the sacrificial lamb. You know, no one's going to win against Reagan. Just throw Mondale up. Who cares? But again, there was a period where Mondale was doing pretty good. He did actually have a legitimate shot. I think most political scientists today would argue Reagan probably always was going to win. But it definitely might have been a lot closer than it was. So let me play a little bit of Mondale talking, a little bit of the flavor of how they're approaching this election.
If this administration has a plan for a better future, they're keeping a secret. Here's the truth about the future. We are living on borrowed money and borrowed time. These deficits hike interest rates, clobber exports, stunt investment, kill jobs, undermine growth, cheat our kids, and shrink our future. Whoever is inaugurated in January, the American people will have to pay Mr. Reagan's bills. The budget will be squeezed. Taxes will go up. And anyone who says they won't is not telling the truth to the American people.
And I'll go ahead and stop it there. But by the way, about the raising taxes, he actually was absolutely right about that. Reagan would actually raise taxes towards the end. And George Bush very famously had to raise taxes in his administration. So some of what Mondale's saying there actually did play out, maybe not as harshly as he's describing, but he wasn't completely wrong. In other words, he does have some legitimate criticisms there. This is Mondale's, one of his campaign ads. And again, I want you to notice the music difference and kind of the who is he attracting here, trying to attract here.
Teach your parents well, their children's hell will slowly go by. Don't you ever ask them why, if they told you you would cry. Just look at them and sigh, and know they love you.
So again, this is kind of the beginning of the idea of, you know, country music is conservative rock and roll, although it's more folk sounding there. It's Crosby, Stills, and Nash. We've heard them in this class before. We played a song that they recorded criticizing Richard Nixon after the Ohio State shootings, Kent State shootings. But again, the rock side is sort of the Democratic side, right? It's very 60s. It's, you know, peacenik. This is, of course, in 1984. This is still the height of the nuclear fears. We talked about that last time, late 1983, early 84. I mean, everyone, including Reagan, is talking and worried about nuclear war. So they're leaning into that much more. So, you watch it today and you think, oh, you know, knowing kind of how politics, especially conservative politics, are going to go, you realize like this is not going to attract anybody from the other side onto your side. And again, it is 84 is a very much a transitional year as the 60s and Watergate politics are kind of being sort of pushed aside. And we're now kind of moving into almost a new era at this point. In addition to Jesse Jackson as one of the first major African-American presidential candidates, we also get our first major female presidential candidate. When I say major, what I really mean is one of the two main parties, Democrat or Republicans. I mean, anybody can run for president. If you look at the ballots when you vote, sometimes there's as many as 20 names on the ballots. But the reality is, you know, none of them have a shot. But this was a big deal in 1984 that Walter Mondale chose Geraldine Ferraro to be his vice presidential candidate. Today, we don't think twice about this. When we had Hillary Clinton running for president 2016, we have Sarah Palin as the vice presidential candidate in 2008 for the Republicans. Almost every presidential campaign, the primary seasons always have several women involved. Very good chance if Donald Trump runs again. I'm dating myself because if somebody's listening to this after 2024, you'll see how wrong I am probably. But there's a lot of, if he runs again, there's a lot of talk that he may choose. There's a couple of women that they're talking about he may choose. Again, it's kind of hard sometimes to remember how revolutionary this was that Geraldine Ferraro was chosen at that time. She has now passed on. But she was a pretty big player in New York politics. She was New York U.S. representative from 79 to 85. Like Mondale, she'll also go on to be a U.N. ambassador, this time to the Commission of U.S. Human Rights, also under Bill Clinton. They played up the fact that this is, you know, kind of post women's movement, post ERA movement. You know, it's time. And it's interesting to really go back and, you know, there was a lot of concern that, you know, legitimate concern, I shouldn't say legitimate, but what I meant by that is a lot of people legitimately had this fear. I mean, that they weren't just being funny. They legitimately thought, can a woman be president? Are women too emotional to do this? I mean, this is real talk at the time. There was talk, what if a woman gets pregnant? And I'm being very crude here, but this actually came up, you know, what if she's going through PMS and she gets overly emotional? Can women stand up to male leaders like, you know, Gorbachev or something? I mean, today we roll our eyes at that kind of language. In fact, it's almost gone the other way. I think during Hillary Clinton's campaign, it was like, she's too tough, she's too mean, you know. But again, that was something that, you know, that rampant sexism was something that was still very prevalent because this just simply hadn't happened in politics before. And to some degree, even somewhat innocuous events kind of were cast in a new light because now you have gender differences here.
On the convention floor, all of our delegates' passes are split evenly between men and women. Half men, half women. I looked at that floor and the delegates were not half men. And I found out later that the delegates, a lot of the male delegates, had given their floor passes to their female alternates from their states so that their females, their women, could join me on the floor of the convention, which I thought was really wonderful. But I also got such a charge looking at a lot of the female reporters who were there, who were standing there with tears rolling down their faces. It was unbelievable.
And this is, I'm going to play a couple of clips here. So I was setting up a different clip, but I'm going to go ahead and play these real quick. So Geraldine Ferraro is not only the first female presidential, in this case, vice presidential candidate for a major party, but she also was the first Italian American. And so that was a big deal. And so her Italian family were responding in a big
The family, 94-year-old Aunt Rosa, cousin Carlo, his wife Letizia, and daughter Donatella, watched with a mixture of admiration and disbelief as the news came on Italian television that the relative they had not seen for 26 years had been picked to be Walter Mondale's running mate. Aunt Rosa lapsed into Italian slang to express her joy. You can't imagine how happy, she says.
It is a delicate balance that vice presidential candidate Geraldine Ferraro is deftly maintaining. While she came to San Diego County to talk tough about crime, she did it with a sense of humor, a sense of warmth. Unlike her male counterparts, Ferraro must seem strong without being harsh. At the Chula Vista Police Department, for instance, when she chided officials for the lack of female officers.
Tell me about the women in this department. How many women are you?
Five.
Five out of how many?
99.
Oh. Yeah, that's not so hot.
But while Ferraro was inside joking about affirmative action, outside, protesters were not joking. Right to life supporters are angry with Ferraro's pro-choice stance on abortion.
It's pro-choice for the woman, but it's no choice for the baby.
Two things there with that clip. The first part of it, I was kind of setting up a moment ago where because she's a woman, it changes the nature of, like, you know, sort of how she's perceived. You know, it's not just listening to the substance, but like how she's saying it. Oh, is she being harsh? Is she being too wimpy? Is she being too this or that? So, you know, again, this weird, delicate balance that she has to strike. The other thing about that clip is the fact that, you know, here we're 11 years after Roe v. Wade, and the abortion issue has grown and grown and grown as a major political issue. So there's always been lots of people, of course, who were pro-life. But again, in the early 70s, a lot of people were more like, say, my mother, who was privately pro-life, but publicly or officially pro-choice. As she always said, I would never have an abortion, but I wouldn't take the right away from somebody else. And that was kind of a common stance in the early 70s. As we get into the 80s, the pro-life movement becomes a much, much larger movement. And again, Geraldine Ferraro being a woman sort of got a lot of that focus. And again, if you follow American politics at this time, you know, as you get into the late 80s and definitely into the 90s, the abortion issue becomes just larger and larger to the point that obviously today it's one of the biggest issues in American politics. And you can really start to see that rise up more and more in 1984. Another example of sort of how Ferraro's gender affects politics. This is a clip between the debate between Vice President George Bush and Ferraro. And again, as I've mentioned earlier, Bush was not always the suavest. He always sounded frustrated. He always sounded kind of, he always sounds as like he's not a very nice person. And again, he kind of says out loud sometimes things he shouldn't say. And so it's interesting, this is a short little clip Ferraro has just complained about Reagan's policies in Lebanon and Iran, and Bush is criticizing her for that critique. And the way he starts it, a lot of people found very sexist. So I'm just going to play a little bit of this.
Let me help you with the difference, Ms. Ferraro, between Iran and the embassy in Lebanon. Iran, we were held by a foreign government. In Lebanon, you had a wanton terrorist action where the government opposed it.
Congresswoman Ferraro.
Let me just say, first of all, that I almost resent, Vice President Bush, your patronizing attitude that you have to teach me about foreign policy.
And it is, that was taken from a documentary on George Bush. But it's interesting because I think it depends on your perspective. I mean, you can find other clips of George Bush being kind of scolding to other opponents that aren't women. At the same time, though, there is a patronizing element to it. And so, again, is it on purpose? Is it deliberate? Is it unconscious? Or is it not there at all? But because she's, you know, and that's what I mean by sometimes whether things are there or not, it just changes the nature of politics a little bit here. I'd be curious what you guys think. Was he being sexist there, or, you know, and she definitely took it as that. And actually the press took it as that too. He got highly criticized for that little moment. Again, politics were very different back then. It was these little moments that were controversies. The last debate we had, 2020, one of the candidates literally told the other candidate to shut up. So we're in very different territory today. But the vice president, despite the historic nature of the vice presidential campaign, really, obviously, all eyes really were on the main campaign, which was the two presidential campaigns, Reagan versus Mondale. Now, I've talked before about the fact that if you are the incumbent president, it's actually not really a good idea to debate. You have to today. By 1984, 38 years ago, it was already like accepted you were going to debate probably two or three times before the election. Again, remember the first televised debate and really the first debate was 1960, Kennedy Nixon. There hadn't been presidential debates before 1960. And that was the last one until 1976. But by 84, everyone's doing this. But the problem is when you are the incumbent president, everything you say, people are going to take. You know, it's not just, you're not just talking, you are now the president saying it. We saw that with Ford. But what we saw with Carter is the fact that often, you know, you don't prepare yourself as much. And we talked about how Jimmy Carter just didn't prepare and people tried to get him ready and he just rejected it and he didn't want to take criticism. Reagan's campaign tried to do the opposite. They tried to over-prepare him. And the reality is his very first debate, he bombed. And again, this is very typical. We see this over and over again, that usually for the incumbent president, their first debate is terrible. This happened to Donald Trump in 2020. That's when that was that moment when Biden told him to shut up, and that, which I hated hearing. But at the same time, I was watching that with a crowd of about 100 students, and half the crowd, well, more than half, and most of them were Trump supporters, laughed and said, thank God, because Trump was just overplaying it. We see Obama doing this in 2012. His first debate was awful. So this is George W. Bush's first debate, 2004, was awful. This is actually a pretty common pattern, and we see this with Reagan. And it started raising concerns. Did he get mixed up? He clearly looked tired. And there was a lot of debate of, does he really know anything? But also, is he just simply too old? So the second debate, there's no doubt Reagan came back and won it. And I'm going to play you a couple of the major clips from that. So in other words, there was this moment after the first debate where Mondale did seem to perhaps have the upper hand. I have to be honest, I did cheat on these. I love my magazine covers. But the one on the left is actually, if you notice, it's from 1983. It's a little bit earlier. I just liked it. It fit the debate, so I used it. But in case anybody's eagle-eyed, you may notice that's actually not from 1984. Okay. So here is the second debate. And obviously, this is well rehearsed. They knew this question was going to come up, and Reagan had a great response.
You already are the oldest president in history, and some of your staff say you are tired after your most recent encounter with Mr. Mondale. I recall yet that President Kennedy had to go for days on end with very little sleep during the Cuba Missile Crisis. Is there any doubt in your mind that you would be able to function in such circumstances?
Not at all, Mr. Truitt, and I want you to know that also I will not make age an issue of this campaign. I am not going to exploit for political purposes my opponent's youth and inexperience.
I mean, it's a great line. It's a rehearsed line. It was a line written for him, but I mean, it's a great line. And it is interesting, when you go back and watch these debates, and there's real differences, they really do argue. But again, coming at it 38 years later and seeing, you know, how vicious politics can be right now, it is interesting the joviality of it, even though they are very different. You know, but Mondale even himself said, you know, I can't stand his policies, but I can't help but like the guy. So it is interesting, the politeness, the laughter, even during these debates that you just almost can't imagine happening today.
You already are.
If you guys remember during 1980, there was a line where Jimmy Carter was talking about healthcare, and Reagan looked at him and says, "There you go again." Well, here went Reagan again.
Mr. Reagan, after the election, is going to have to propose a tax increase.
You know, I wasn't going to say this at all, but I can't help it. There you go again. I don't have a plan to tax or increase taxes. I'm not going to increase taxes. I can understand why you are, Mr. Mondale, because as a senator, you voted 16 times to increase taxes.
Mr. President, you said, there you go again. Right? Remember the last time you said that? Mm-hmm. You said it when President Carter said that you were going to cut Medicare. And you said, oh no, there you go again, Mr. President. And what did you do right after the election? You went out and tried to cut $20 billion out of Medicare.
So I went ahead and played the whole longer in the clip because I did want to show that. I mean, you know, again, I just played up the joviality. I mean, they did go at each other. I don't want to overplay the fact that they were lovey-dovey. But again, what everybody remembered wasn't, which is a good comeback on Mondale's part. I mean, he jumped in there because he knew that was coming at some point. But what everybody remembers is just, there you go again. That was played over and over and over on TV news the next day. Not surprisingly, I mean, Reagan did very good in that second debate. He was already very popular, and it was, at least electorally speaking, it was an absolute blowout, the biggest blowout we've ever had. I mean, it's almost shocking when you look at the maps. So the only two places Mondale won the electoral vote was Washington, D.C., and his home state of Minnesota. And one of the reasons he won Minnesota, he is liked there, but Reagan did not campaign there. And apparently at one point he said, let him have his home state. I don't have to beat him in every state. And so it is absolutely is a blowout. And this is really kind of the main pillar, if you will, in sort of the myth of the power of Reagan. And it is an amazing accomplishment. There's no taking away from that. This was one of the political cartoons the day after the election. It's Reagan's America. The face of America is Reagan's America. And again, I love graphics and such. And so again, this is, I think it makes it even look more pathetic, you know, just literally showing, you know, how many electoral votes Reagan got over Mondale. But again, as we'll see in a moment, I'm going to drill down on those numbers a little bit. It wasn't quite the blowout when you really start looking at numbers. And that matters because Reagan wasn't popular with everybody. So how did he do it? I mean, how did he go to that big of a blowout, considering he did have some real issues he was dealing with? There were a lot of people who really felt alienated by Reagan. I mean, I think even though many people today weren't alive, or you know, like in my case, I was just a kid during this period. Many people weren't alive during Reagan's years. But yet, I still think when people talk about Reagan, it can kind of divide people. Some people see them as representing them, and other people do not. And that was the case in 1984. I mean, a lot of people who were, you know, on the left. I mean, this is a period where the term liberal becomes an ugly word. I mean, every American would call themselves a liberal at one point. Liberal comes from the word liberty. Of course, people today oftentimes talk about classical liberals, which just means individual choice. I mean, America is a liberal institution. We vote, we have freedom of religion, freedom of speech. Those are liberal ideas. But it's during the 1980s in particular where liberal becomes synonymous with left wing, and then it becomes an ugly word. And to the day that nobody wants to call themselves a liberal anymore. Like, oh, I'm not a liberal. You know, people always start conversations with, no, I'm not a liberal, but, you know. But people who still would throw the term around liberal, you know, people on the left did not like Reagan. People who consider themselves progressives would not have liked Reagan, which again were the mainstream of American politics. You know, we can see with Woodrow Wilson, obviously Franklin Roosevelt, Harry Truman, and Kennedy, Johnson. I mean, even Nixon and Ford have liberal progressive ideas. By 1980s, that was dead for all intents and purposes. A lot of working women saw Reagan as not an ally to them. Many African Americans did not see him as an ally. He cut a lot of services they depended on. He was not an ardent supporter of the civil rights movement in the 60s. There is no real evidence that Reagan was openly racist or anything like that. I mean, we have his private writings, we have private recordings, but at the same time, he just didn't seem to think much about African Americans in any way or fashion, just meaning like, almost kind of blind to the plight of African Americans, not so much hatred or purposeful manipulation, but just kind of blind to it, you know. So many of them just felt like he was not witnessing, he was not, you know, seeing their plight, if you will. And labor, working people, especially unions, really saw a Reagan as an enemy to them. So again, when you look at these numbers, you can do the same thing with the 1980 election. You know, 1980 election, only 51% of the registered voters actually voted. 1984, a couple more voters, so 53% of registered voters. So anybody, again, at this point, anybody over 18 who's not a felon, who's registered to vote, but 47% of that group sat it out. I mean, this is one of the lowest, 80 and 84 are some of the lowest turnout for a presidential election ever. So that's already a huge part of the electorate that didn't even say, you know, and when you look at the actual popular vote, not the electoral vote is what gets you elected, of course, that's what matters. But again, when we're looking at popularity, you have to look at the popular vote. And again, Reagan gets 50, he still gets the majority of the popular vote, no doubt about that, but it's only 55%. And again, that's only up 53%. Mondale gets almost 40%. So, you know, the electoral vote gives a sense that everybody was a Reagan supporter. When you really start looking at the numbers, you do see there's more divisions than people might realize. If you're just looking at the electoral results. So we're talking about 55 million voted for Reagan and about 38 million voted for Mondale. So again, it's not quite 2-1. You know, it's definitely not 49-1 as the electoral vote shows. But for all intents and purposes, politically speaking, Reagan and the Reagan Revolution, if you will, is the mainstream of politics at this point. This was another political cartoon after the initial election of Reagan saying, you know, we're seeing the end of classical liberalism in America. So again, how did he do it? What was his coalition? In other words, how does he pull these people together? I mean, every president, once they're elected, and you know, it's always interesting to go, well, who actually supported them and how did this work? So again, people who supported Reagan, I mean, you're talking really lots of groups that weren't necessarily a natural fit together. So one aspect of Reagan, without a doubt, and again, this is where I think alienated many African-Americans, is there clearly was kind of a white middle-class backlash to a lot of federal programs of the 60s and 70s. There was a growing sense that the federal government cared more for women, or in particular African-Americans, than they did for, say, white male middle-class workers or working-class people. You know, this idea that, you know, government's more concerned with making sure you have enough Black workers than making sure that any of the workers are fine. So there's a real hatred by many voters of affirmative action, of busing. And again, I'm going to explain a little bit of busing now, because a lot of people, a lot of college students today may not have ever been bused. I grew up being bused. So let me explain what we mean when we say busing, because this was a big issue in the 80s. And it definitely affected the 1984 election, because Reagan was anti-busing. So we get the civil rights movement, and you get things such as the 1964 Civil Rights Act, the 1965 Voting Rights Act. And so we're entering a period of integration. But of course, because of segregation, cities were divided. You had black schools and white schools. So even if you say they're integrated, they still become white schools and black schools, because people are physically separated from each other. There's a lot of reasons for that, including redlining and house loans. So there was a push in the late 60s and into the 70s to kind of make an effort to put these schools together. So some cities, like I think this might be a case down in Bainbridge, is where they kind of just shut down the black school and everybody went to the white school. But in bigger cities, you had too many people. You couldn't just shut down one school and make everybody go to the same school. You needed all the schools. But again, if you live like I did, you know, in the white middle class, mostly white, although actually my neighborhood was actually quite diverse, but still more overly white middle class, you know, and then I had, you know, then you had very poor, you know, black or Latino neighborhoods across town, we would never see each other. And of course, the downside of that is the schools in my part of town, for instance, would had better tax bracket. They would attract better teachers. The poorer schools, you may get the teachers that aren't quite as good. So the idea of everybody goes to each other's schools, you're going to get a much fairer distribution of money. You're going to get better teachers all around, and it's going to uplift everybody. So what they started doing in a lot of big cities was literally busing. Initially, it was black students into the white areas to go to school and then bus them back home in the afternoons. But then it also went the other way, where white students, and again, it wasn't always white or black. It was more just students from one area of a city being bused to schools in another area of the city. But it did tend to work out where it's mostly black in one area, mostly white in the other. A couple of cities were doing this. It was very controversial. The Supreme Court ruled in 1971 in the Swan decision. This dealt with Charlotte, North Carolina, that this is constitutional and that it is fair. And after 1971, busing became pretty much the policy of most major cities. Interestingly enough, the biggest pushbacks on busing was not in the South, but was actually in places like California, and in particular, Boston. Boston gets most of the attention. I mean, it really got violent in Boston over this. And most of the studies of the busing issue that have come out usually look at Boston as their main focus. The whole idea of busing, which I'm not going to be honest, just give my own personal opinion. Again, I went to elementary school, a school about a mile from my house. It was a diverse school, but I didn't even realize a lot of my friends, one of my best friends, a guy named Ramon Williams. He was one of our best students. He's African American. And I never thought about the fact that he didn't live near me. And so he was one of the students bused to my school. And then in sixth grade, we were bused. My neighborhood were bused to a school called Carter Jew Woodson, which is across town. That's where Ramon Williams lived. That would have been his elementary school. And I can still remember that first day. And this is the part of town I've never been in. It was mostly black. It was very poor. And for me, I'm not going to lie, it was a very eye-opening experience. I didn't realize that there were people in Jacksonville who lived this poor. And, you know, and I realized this is where Ramon's from. Oh my gosh, you know. And so I have to be honest, I actually think it was a healthy thing. And I kind of enjoyed the long bus ride. You know, we hung out in the bus and talked and stuff. So again, I feel like it was a good thing, but a lot of people did not. Many parents absolutely hated it. And I knew a lot of friends that this is when they went to private school was because they were so concerned over busing. Everybody went to elementary school the fifth grade. And then a lot of my middle-class friends, they started going to private school in sixth and seventh grade because those were the busing years for us. And then eighth grade, they came back because we quit being bused. But anyway. If you look at the number, 80s is the peak of busing. This is when I was bused. 84, since that's the year we're talking about, that was the first year I was bused across town. Again, if you actually look at polls, only about 17% of white parents would have supported it. My parents, I think, would have been in it. They weren't angry about it. I think they would have preferred I not do it, but they would have said they were for it for the most part. and 60% of Black parents. Now, again, if you notice, it's not 100%. I mean, again, a lot of African Americans resented this as well, this kind of social experimentation. Again, and I think that, you know, it's still up to opinion whether this was a good thing or not. My experience was good. But anyway, I just want to know, because I've said this to students before, I mentioned busing, and they kind of look at me like, what are you talking about? Especially, not only if you're younger, but also if you grew up in a really small town, this probably wasn't something you had to think about. If you lived in the bigger city, this was one of the big issues of the 70s and 80s. By the 1990s, the whole idea of busing declined. I don't think anybody does it anymore. And the 90s is also when you started hearing the language of school choice, which you still hear today. But that's where the idea is, I don't want to go to just any school. I want to choose the school for my student, for my kids. The government can't tell me where my kids should go. I'm going to choose. So terms like school choice became a big political term in the 1990s. Anyway, so that's one group. And again, it is mostly a white backlash, but to be fair, also just kind of a sense of not wanting too many social programs, voters that were kind of tired of sort of the social programs of federal government that we see, you know, after the New Deal, and especially after the Civil Rights Movement. On the other hand, those people, many of them Democrats. In fact, this is where we get the term neocon, meaning new conservatives. So if you look back in the 40s and 50s, early 60s, it was really Democrats that were driving the Cold War. Roosevelt, I mean, I know he was very friendly with Russia earlier on, but even towards the end of his term before he died, he was getting very suspicious of Russia. Truman, definitely. I mean, he goes into the Korean War. Kennedy and Johnson both escalating the Vietnam War. So there were a lot of Democrats that really wanted to be tough on communists. By the 70s and 80s, suddenly this becomes seen as more of a conservative Republican issue. And so a lot of those sort of hawkish Democrats switch over to the conservative side, and they become known as neocons, the new conservatives. So we get these, both on the right and left, you get these Cold War hawks that want bigger defense. And they liked Reagan's rhetoric. They liked the increased defense spending. So you're getting both Democrats and Republicans. But notice I'm not saying Republicans here. I'm talking about groups that may normally voted Democrat, now switching over to Reagan, the classic Reagan Democrat. Economic conservatives, again, people who think we're paying too many taxes, giving too much money away to poor people. Unions have way too much power. So they like Reagan's toughness on economics. And again, a lot of unions, I mentioned a moment ago that labor didn't like Reagan. And I do want to talk about another event that you may not be familiar with that really was kind of the clarion call, the whistle going off for unions. So in 1981, this is early in Reagan's administration, air traffic controllers who had a union called PATCO, they went on strike. Now, the problem with that is because, you know, it's a high pressure job, has high heart attack rates. But yet they keep the planes flying. And they did sign a contract with the government that they would not go on strike. But there's plenty of things that people say they won't do that they do anyway. I mean, we do see senators that and representatives that are supposed to pass a budget that choose not to pass a budget and shut down the government. So, you know, a lot of people argue, well, yeah, you signed a contract. But anyway, they did sign a contract. So they threatened to go on strike and kind of calling Reagan's bluff. Reagan kept saying, you can't do this. I'm going to fire you if you do it. And they called their bluff. And this was, you know, this kind of big moment, you know, how conservative is Reagan? How serious is he about going after unions? So this was a big moment in labor history. And this was Reagan's response.
This morning at 7 a.m., the union representing those who man America's air traffic control facilities called a strike. This was the culmination of 7 months of negotiations between the Federal Aviation Administration and the union. At one point in these negotiations, agreement was reached and signed by both sides, granting a $40 million increase in salaries and benefits. This is twice what other government employees can expect. It was granted in recognition of the difficulties inherent in the work these people perform. Now, however, the union demands are 17 times what had been agreed to, $681 million. This would impose a tax burden on their fellow citizens, which is unacceptable. I would like to thank the supervisors and controllers who are on the job today helping to get the nation's air system operating safely. In the New York area, for example, four supervisors were scheduled to report for work and 17 additionally volunteered. At National Airport, a traffic controller told a news person he had resigned from the union and reported to work because, quote, how can I ask my kids to obey the law if I don't, end quote. This is a great tribute to America. Let me make one thing plain. I respect the right of workers in the private sector to strike. Indeed, as president of my own union, I led the first strike ever called by that union. I guess I'm maybe the first one to ever hold this office who is a lifetime member of an AFL-CIO union. But we cannot compare labor-management relations in the private sector with government.
So, and Reagan's very aware, I mean, he's absolutely right that he had been president of the Screen Actors Guild, but he's very aware that by calling their bluff, he has actually alienated a lot of unions, which were big voters. But so he basically gave a warning, they went on strike, so he fired over 11,000 workers. And again, for labor, for unions, it was a shock. And he held to it. And again, a lot of people supported him on this. I mean, obviously, that was a big group, that people that thought unions had too much power. They loved that Reagan stuck to his guns. But for a lot of workers, especially union workers, this was, oh, this guy's not on our side. And you know, so that was a major group that did not support Reagan. Anyway, back to his supporters. And then, of course, you get people that might identify either officially or at least in the way they think as libertarians. And again, libertarian comes also from the word liberty, that want smaller government, less government influence in our lives, you know, keep us protected from outside forces, keep the dollar running. But when it comes to personal decisions, let us make our own decisions. So they liked the philosophy of Reagan of less government. You know, Reagan very famously said, government doesn't solve problems, government is the problem. Or another line he says, and I think I've played this in a different lecture, the nine most terrifying words in the English language, I'm from the government and I'm here to help. So libertarians love that kind of rhetoric coming from Reagan. And again, these are people that weren't necessarily, we think of as one group of people coming together. Let's talk a little bit about Reagan's economics. I'm going to kind of cover this twice. So quick overview, then we'll dig just a little bit into this. I won't spend as much time as we did with Nixon. So it's what's sometimes called the Reagan Revolution. These very serious changes that Reagan brought, in particular to government spending and taxation. So starting in 1981, he had a whole series of tax cuts, in particular for the elites, the top tax bracket and corporations. He also instituted a lot of budget reductions for a lot of government programs. For instance, the top tax rate, which meaning, you know, if you make a certain amount of money, you have to pay a certain percentage. This goes back to 1913 when the first income tax came about. It's a graduated income tax. So the argument is, and I'm making these numbers up, but if you only make, you know, $100 a year, obviously if you're paying, you know, 25% of $100, it's like life or death. But if you're making $100 million a year, the 25% is not going to not put food on your table. So the argument has always been the more you make, the more you pay, the less you make, the less you pay. A lot of people say, let's have a flat tax rate of say 15%. But of course, many people who support that don't realize that their taxes would actually go up. About 47% of Americans don't make enough money to pay income tax. And not only that, those who do usually pay 8-9% taxes. So anyway, but in the 1950s, the top bracket were paying 90% taxes. Now, most of them didn't pay that. They found ways to get out of it, but 90%. By 1981, it was down to 70%. But that means, you know, again, if you don't find any way to get out of it, tax breaks or tax shelters, if you make $1 million a year, you're paying $700,000 in taxes, is essentially what that means. So his cutting that top tax rate from 70% eventually down to 28%. I think today it's about 35%, I think, is about what the top tax. So it's gone up a little bit since Reagan. And this became known as supply side economics or trickle down economics. And we'll talk more of what these mean in just a second. So this is essentially the Reagan Revolution. And there's a lot of debate at the time and even today, did this work or not? And the answer is ambiguous, actually. So some of the core ideas built into Reagan, and again, it's not just Reagan. I mean, Reagan supported this, but you're really talking about his administration and economic advisors and such that are pushing this. But it's really one person that we kind of talk about more than anybody other, an economist named Arthur Laffer, who's still around, by the way. He's up there, but he's actually still around today. And something known as the Laffer Curve, which you see, this is him in the 1970s with the Laffer Curve behind him. He came up with this in 1974. And as Laffer has made very clear, there's plenty of people who have talked about this. He just became associated with it more than anybody else. And then there are a couple reporters from the Wall Street Journal that very much popularized his ideas to the point that by 1980, this was kind of standard conservative sort of rhetoric when it comes to economy. This is a napkin that Laffer was drawing his ideas on and actually ended up giving this to Chief of Staff Donna Rumsfeld, who worked for Gerald Ford at the point. And in fact, this napkin is in the Smithsonian Museum of American History because the Laffer Curve became sort of major economic policy. So here's what it essentially is. So basically, it's arguing that, you know, government has to have taxes to run. I mean, that's how it works. You have to have defense, you have to have services. But the argument is if you tax, and that's the bottom line there, if you tax too much, again, say 70%, you know, obviously you tax 100%, nobody has any money. But let's say if you're taxing 70%, let's say, you know, you're the millionaire, you're the top tax bracket. The argument is, well, you're not going to spend any money. You're just going to, you know, pay your taxes. And any money you have, you're just going to hang on to it because it's all you got. The argument is if you lower the taxes on, say, the top tax rate, and you think, well, why the top? Why not the bottom? Well, because the top, they're the business owners. They're the factory owners. They're the people with the money. And we got a lot of people without money. Well, we got to get it somehow. So this is how you do it. So the argument is, You lower the taxes so more money stays in the corporations or more money stays in the pockets of the rich. And then they will invest that money in the economy. They'll build new businesses. They'll build more homes. They'll hire more people because they got more money to play with. And therefore, it trickles down to everybody else. So you give it to the suppliers, supply side economics, the people who have the supply. And then again, they will take that tax savings and reinvest it into the economy with new jobs, new businesses, new construction. And then it trickles down to the workers. It makes goods cheaper. So that also helps us out. And so again, it spreads the wealth, not through government redistribution, but through actual economy. Again, it's pushing the idea of enriching people from the public sector to the private sector. And what Laffer argues, I mean, that's the core idea, but he argues there is kind of a magic. I mean, you don't want to have any taxes, but at the same time, you don't want too many. And there is this kind of magical sweet spot where you get a lot of revenue, but you're also cutting your taxes. And so the argument is the first year or two, in fact, I think I have it broken down here. The first year or two, yeah, you're probably going to have a loss in taxes. But as the economy starts to pick up, ultimately, you will get more taxes. So, you know, the conundrum is, or the irony is, according to Laffer and Reaganomic people, is that, yes, you're cutting taxes, but in the long run, you're getting more taxes because the economy will be even better. You'll have more people at that top tax bracket. So for instance, and Laffer was hired by Reagan to work on his economic advisory board. So he was directly involved in this. And so, you know, he says, okay, 81, we're going to lose maybe $8.99 billion in tax revenue. 82, we're going to lose as many as $53 billion in tax revenue. But by 1983, we'll have $100 billion gain. And by 1986, it'll be over $200 billion gain in taxes. So yes, we take a loss at the beginning, but then we get it back. That never quite happened the way it was supposed to. And there's a lot of reasons why they argue it didn't quite happen. There was an unexpected recession that hit in. There are some other issues that hit in. So it never quite happened. But I don't want to give a complete verdict yet. So again, because there's more profits, you invest more, and then that would trickle down to the workers. This was the argument behind it. So beginning in 1981, although there will be more tax cuts later, but in 1981, this is really August 81. I mean, this is what happened after the shooting attempt. Reagan was trying to get this through. He had a hard time. He gets, you know, assassination attempt. This actually helped him get this passed. He also was, he and the administration were very good at lobbying. They really did push this hard. So he does get the biggest tax cut ever in American history. And again, depending on your philosophy, some people may think that's the greatest thing ever. Other people think this is a horrible thing. But for personal taxes, over $50 billion cut over 5 years, over $150 billion in corporation taxes are cut over the next 5 years. And also something else he does as part of this is he begins to deregulate businesses. Now, this actually happened also under Jimmy Carter and Gerald Ford. This is something that, always gets either credited or blamed to Reagan. But actually, this was already happening. In fact, I think I talked about this when I talked about the Nixon shock. You know, I think a lot of people today are really surprised just how much the federal government used to regulate things. They regulated trucks. They regulated which flights were in the air, how many flights could go at one time, how much airlines could charge. So actually in the 70s, we begin to see this deregulation sort of move. Reagan just accelerated it. And also cutting a lot of the social services and pushing them to the private sector. So is this Reaganomics as it becomes known, or is Bush right? Is it voodoo economics? And again, this is a political cartoon arguing, you know, do the poor really, does it really trickle down to the poor or not? Or is this just a myth? And again, if it's trickling down, even if it does work, it is literally a trickle, right? Instead of a, you know, a true redistribution, it's literally just getting the crumbs. So the question is, will the CEOs, will the elites, will the people with the money? So let's say you're Donald Trump, somebody who very much benefited from this. So you're Donald Trump, you're a real estate broker. You get huge breaks, tax breaks. Do you just stuff those millions of dollars in your pockets, or do you give your workers raises? Do you hire more workers? Or do you say, hey, we just made a lot of money this year, a lot more than we thought we were going to make. We don't need 10,000 workers. We're going to pull a Twitter. Again, I'm dating myself because it's 2022 and Elon Musk just fired about 4,000 workers. And I think, Facebook just fired 11,000 workers this week. So do you say, hey, we're making more money because of tax breaks? We don't need all these workers now. Or do you actually pass it on? Do you pass those profits on to your workers? The answer is both seems to have happened. This is why this is an ambiguous one. This is why both sides have good arguments. We do see some corporations investing more. We do see some corporations absolutely expanding, hiring more people. We do see unemployment go down. But we also see a lot of other businesses saying, hey, we're making good money because we're getting all these tax breaks. We really don't need to expand anymore because we're making tons of money. We can actually cut our workers. So we do actually see both outcomes. This is why Democrats and Republicans can both make very good arguments that Reaganomics were good or they were bad voodoo economics. By the way, this image here, again, a lot of labor really, really, really did not like Reagan and Reaganomics because a lot of them did lose their job under Reaganomics. But I did want to point out something else you may not be familiar with. You notice in the back, the red sign says, Ronnie, thanks for the cheese. Where's the bread? I mean, where's the money? You may not realize what that's referring to. Some of you may have heard of, you know, people living on government cheese. You still hear people make that phrase, government cheese. So I do a little aside here to explain the whole phenomena of government cheese. So there's been a program in the federal government going back to the New Deal to help farmers. So if farmers are hurting, the federal government can invest money in farms to get those prices up, maybe even buy products for farmers to give them profits. And so in the 1970s, during the OPEC oil crisis and the recession, dairy farmers were hurting a lot. So the federal government actually had this huge program to buy a lot of cheese from dairy farmers. And what happened is by 1980, and again, the whole idea is, well, we can redistribute it if we ever need to, because cheese does last a long time. So by the 1980s, 35 states you know, across 35 states in the union, there was over 500 million pounds of cheese that the government owned. And this was seen as kind of a boondoggle. This was seen as government waste. But in 1981, 82, we do go into another recession. And so Reagan was convinced to give the cheese to poor families. And so government cheese did become a thing, where people would get cheese from the government as a way to kind of help them out during rough times. So the image of government cheese becomes kind of a synonymous for welfare, if you will. So you will hear lots of jokes in the 80s and 90s about government cheese. Okay, so I've already kind of given one verdict that it's mixed results here. So what are some of the other results of Reaganomics? So 1982, we do see a major recession. But we do see a rise in the gross domestic product. Americans as a nation do seem to be making more stuff once you get past a recession. Stocks did boom. Inflation decreased from 13.5% in 1980 to, by the end of Reagan's administration, to just 3.5% inflation. But at the same time, so again, for some people, they did great. For corporations, they did wonderful. For some of the middle class, they did great. But at the same time, we not only see recessions in 82, we see a worse one in 87. And to get into Bush's administration, we see a massive one in 1992. In fact, this is why Clinton becomes president, because Bush, the economy was so bad at the end of the Bush administration that it switched to Clinton. That's in a later lecture. We do see much higher inequality. This is something we talk a lot more about today. Things were not nowhere near as bad then as they are today when it comes to the haves and have-nots. But again, we see top 1% control about 40% of U.S. wealth. That is a lot higher percentage today than it was even back then. Wages kind of plateau. They don't really rise or fall. They just kind of, the middle class was there. Some do enter it, but actually the middle class kind of just stays stagnant for the most part. So in the middle class, they are doing pretty good, but there's not a growing middle class in the way we see, say, in the 50s, where we see this massive expansion of the middle class. It just kind of stays stagnant. And for those who were poor, life actually got worse in age, because there was less social services, there were less jobs. There was even just kind of an anti-poor attitude in America. So for a lot of people, life actually got worse in the 80s, not better. Again, cutting those social services included things like state hospitals. So if you had mental problems, it was very common to go to a state hospital. Government would fund it. Well, a lot of these state hospitals were shut down in the early to mid 80s. And what happened was a lot of these patients were literally just let go. And this is why, by the late 80s, kind of one of the images of the 80s is the rise in homelessness. And a lot of those homeless people were simply people with mental problems. I mean, I think we've all seen the person on the street corner yelling at themselves, you know, and you're like, oh, you know, I mean, that's somebody that probably should be under psychiatric care in many cases. So we do see a rise of homelessness, which becomes kind of a symbol for those who are critical of Reaganomics. And again, you heard Mondale talk about the deficit, meaning we're spending more than we actually have, and we do see the debt shoot up. Again, the debt's so much worse today than it was at the time. But still, this is the beginning of a massive U.S. debt. So again, it depends on which people you're talking about when you talk about Reaganomics. It also kind of depends on your politics and what you think the role of government is as to whether this was a positive or negative. And I think the honest answer is, it was both good and bad. It just depends on how you're looking at it, who you're looking at. Excuse me. There's my first cough. And I mentioned Arthur Laffer already. He is still around as of 2022. And in 2019, I would argue appropriately, Donald Trump, somebody who very much benefited from Reaganomics in the 1980s, did award Arthur Laffer the Congressional Medal of Freedom. And this is him receiving it at the White House, who, by the way, Laffer did work for the Trump campaign and the Trump administration as an economic advisor. So the Laffer influence is still very much still felt in politics today. Despite the real divides between Democrats and Republicans and real debates over economic policy and social policy, there was more bipartisanship than you might imagine in the 80s, although by the late 80s, it's going to start getting ugly. I think the 88 election is really the beginning of really ugly politics in America. I think that's the start of it. And there are a lot of Democrats who truly did not like Reagan's policies. But as Tip O'Neill, the person you see here, the Speaker of the House under Jimmy Carter and under Reagan, a very devout Democrat, a strong liberal, also devout Catholic, Irish American like Reagan was, he always said, I liked Reagan. He said, in fact, he would prefer Reagan's personality and then Carter's policies instead of what he got. I got Carter's personality. You know. Anyway, he did like Reagan. He just completely disagreed with his policies. And Tip O'Neill, when he first met Reagan, which was about 2 weeks into Reagan's presidency, he said, look, I'll work with you. I'm not above working with the other side. He said, in fact, after 6 o'clock, we're all just friends anyway. And Reagan often will call him and say, hey, Tip, is it after six yet? Meaning, can we just talk? Can we just be friends? And it, I mean, it is an endearing thing because you just don't hear that anymore. And so sometimes, even though I do want to talk about the conflicts and stuff, I do kind of want to keep reminding there was a time when politics could be, you know, serious and divisive on one hand, but it can still be very humane and friendly. Anyway, I'm preaching now, so I'll stop doing that. But and when we get into Reagan a little bit, we could argue like how conservative was he? I mean, Tip O'Neill, before he met Reagan, had always heard that Reagan talks a very strong far-right conservative, not so far-right for today, but at the time, far-right conservative line. But when he was governor of California, actually government spending went up, and actually he supported a lot of more left-wing programs. And so Tip O'Neill was genuinely shocked at the Reagan tax cuts. But yet government spending did go up overall under Reagan. Just it was for defense spending and Social Security and Medicare. It was cut for other things. But again, I don't think Reagan completely fits the mold that people put him in. I mean, we start thinking about, like, say, social conservatives today. I mean, he was our first divorced president. He had been married before Nancy Reagan. He was not a regular churchgoer. Now, I think at the time, a lot of people noticed he didn't go to church a lot. Say, look at Carter, who literally taught Sunday school every week. And a lot of people were very snarky about Reagan's religious beliefs. Now, today we're not, because we have his private writings. We know that he really was genuinely quite religious. I mean, those were real feelings that he had, but he wasn't a regular churchgoer. And I think that might be surprising to a lot of people today to realize, oh, he didn't go to church every Sunday. He was privately pro-life, but he was politically pro-choice, even though he did wish abortion didn't exist, but he never, both as governor and as president, he didn't end abortion, if you will. He kept affirmative action. Most of the New Deal programs, major New Deal programs, were kept. Some of the smaller ones were pushed to the state or private level. But most of the major stuff that are big government spending all remained intact under Reagan. He also, for instance, nominated the first female Supreme Court Justice, Sandra Day O'Connor. So I would not consider him a liberal by no means, but maybe a little more centrist than some people might realize, perhaps in some ways. Again, I think we always have to be careful of lumping any president completely in one corner or the other. Let's talk a little bit, we're almost at the end here, but let's talk a little bit about the Supreme Court, because a lot of the Reagan Supreme Court has affected our lives. I think only now, again, are we starting to see the influence of the Reagan Court slowly start to diminish as these justices are beginning to step off or pass away. So Sandra Day O'Connor was indeed the first female member of the Supreme Court. Fortunately, we've had many more since then. Reagan had made this promise that he would do this, and he does. And again, when he nominated her, not long after the assassination attempt, I mean, you know, first off, it's Supreme Court justice is one of the biggest things a president can do. And it's really their long-lasting legacy, because Supreme Court justices can last 30 years or more sometimes. And they really shape our society much more than a president does. And so by nominating her, you know, he knew everybody was going to support her. And she actually got completely affirmative votes. Nobody voted against her. Not only was she well-qualified, but no Democrat wanted to be to vote against her. So she sails through and was a very successful a member of the Supreme Court. He also got in Antonin Scalia, who was very conservative. O'Connor was much more of a centrist. Scalia was very conservative, very what you might call an originalist, and you know, a very tight interpreter of the Constitution. But he comes in 86. This is not long after the 84 election. I mean, Reagan for a couple of years was pretty much untouchable because that 84 election was so powerful. And so, you know, and again, even though I drilled down on the numbers a little bit, overwhelmingly politically, he was hugely popular, obviously. Now, after late 86 is when Reagan's going to get in trouble. And we'll talk about this in another lecture. He will be more vulnerable after 86. But even if Scalia was very, very conservative, he was very charming. He was very a nice person, incredibly intelligent. And it was kind of hard not to like the guy, even if you completely disagreed with his politics. So Reagan's popularity and Scalia's personality also gets him through without any negative votes. But by 87, things change. Reagan is no longer quite as popular as he was in 84. He's in the height of the Iran-Contra affair. We're about to get into a new recession. There's a lot more debates about Reaganomics. All of these we'll cover in later lecture. But he nominates Robert Bork to the Supreme Court. Robert Bork was very similar to Scalia in his attitudes about the Constitution. But he was a lot stronger than even Scalia was. He did not support a lot of civil rights measures of the 60s and 70s. He said these are not constitutional. As he tried to make clear, by the way, this is him with Joe Biden during his confirmation hearings, he said, it's not that I don't support civil rights, I just don't think it's in the Constitution, some of the laws that we passed. He also said, we do not necessarily have a right to privacy. It's not in the Constitution. Even though the Constitution does have an amendment that says the enumeration amendment that basically says there are other rights that we have, even if they're not stated in the Constitution. But he's like, nope, no right to privacy necessarily. It's not guaranteed by the Constitution. So for a lot of people, he was a little too far to the right, if you will. And this is just a weird little tangent. VHS tapes were big at this point. You could, you know, you have the VCR, you got your Rent videos from a video store. So people actually found the movies he rented. Of course, they were hoping it would be like, you know, porn movies or something. You know, they actually were pretty boring movies. They're just regular old movies, apparently. But it kind of shocked everybody, like, oh, and the argument was, well, you say you don't have a right to privacy, so we're going to, you know, no right to privacy, right? Which, by the way, this sparked a law, a move to have a law that to make things like video rentals private. I just discovered this. I know it's going off a weird side road here, but on Letterboxd, a site I use sometimes to log the movies I watch, somebody actually went back to these old newspaper reports, and they actually found they listed all the movies that Robert Bork rented in the 1980s. They're what you would expect somebody who's in their 60s to rent in the 1980s, mostly old movies. Although I did think this one was interesting. First Monday in October, 1981, Walter Matthau and Jill Clayburgh, which is about Supreme Court justice being nominated. So I wondered if he rented this movie when he was nominated. I guess that was funny. Anyway. So he was voted out. One of the biggest defeats for a Supreme Court nomination ever. So Douglas Ginsburg was nominated. Nice guy, seemed to be a little more, you know, mainstream. But it came out during the hearings and the investigation of his background that when he was younger and a college professor, he did smoke marijuana. And again, today people are like, whatever. We've had presidents who have done drugs, but I mean, W. Obama, you know, but Bill Clinton smoked, you know, or at least eight. You know, the big thing about Bill Clinton was he always said, I can't inhale a cigarette, you know, joint. But as one of his friends says, he may not have inhaled, but he liked his edibles. So again, today, the whole idea of marijuana is whether you do it or not is not seen as shocking. But in the 80s, this was still a big deal. It was a felon. And so not only did this look bad, even though it was decades earlier, but the first lady, Nancy Reagan, I mean, she was, this was her campaign. Just say no, no drugs, period. So this looks terrible to nominate Ginsburg. So Ginsburg did offer to withdraw, and Reagan was like, yes, why don't we go that way? That would be a good idea. So finally, after two attempts, he nominates Anthony Kennedy, who only recently stepped down. In fact, it was, I believe this was when Neil Gorsuch came in. Or was it Brett Kavanaugh? It might be Brett Kavanaugh. No, it was Brett Kavanaugh. When Kennedy stepped down, it became Brett Kavanaugh. Scalia, when he passed away, it was Neil Gorsuch that Trump nominated. When Kennedy retired, that was when Brett Kavanaugh was nominated. Anyway, sorry. So Anthony Kennedy was very middle of the road. Reagan even said this when he nominated him, like everybody should like this guy. And he was. He was very much a very politically a moderate and a very successful candidate. We've talked quite a bit about the Cold War. We're going to come back to this. I won't get into the Cold War 1984. I feel like we've covered it already. When we come back for part two, we'll talk more about popular culture and products and consumerism and such. Okay, thanks, guys. I know that went a little while, but hopefully it gave you some insight into the 1980s maybe you didn't know about. All right, talk to you later.